So I think that is a problem for people because they put, which is understandable, of personality. I mean, for myself, yeah, we came up with the idea for a personal problem that I saw years back. We saw it on the business side begin, so we built a solution that it's not my personality, it's not who I am. And I know I'm a good team builder for a start. I'm not good at human resources. As a human resources manager, I'd fire myself right away. And I know I'm a good enough human resources manager to know when I have to give myself a kick in the butt and say, you are now actually stopping progress. Get the person who does it better. We were very happy with that to see it. And what things go to the person? Does it say anything about the person? I think that's, in particular in Germany, something that is a massive issue. I am the company, and super. It can work, as I said. There are some very successful companies who are run like that, but more often, I would say it's too dangerous for a company, and you're not doing this on the service.
Because you want the best of the company,
for somebody else.
So, do you see that startups in Germany, they see more themselves as the face of the company again? Because from my understanding, there are some VCs in Berlin and in Germany, but when you compare it with London and Paris, do you see a different approach, or do you think that they may work in a different way? Or how do they, you know, if a German company wants to invest in a German startup, how would they, what would it be the expectations? Apart from the normal having a good business and everything, but would they be looking to go international? Would they be looking to just grow locally? It's a long question.
In German
specifically? No, it can be Netherlands because it does have a finance. But yes, okay.
I know this is one tiny part because we're always pushing into that, which is healthcare. And the big players in the healthcare market are the buyers, the American companies. And what I see, what they look at is, does this contribute to my existing business? Which is fine, which is understandable. Because they're the bottom line, and they must provide the annual economy because they're maybe most of them are stock exchanges. I think it's a bit nearsighted at times because you could still be staring at a once in a lifetime opportunity for a new business. And what they're clever enough to possible because they say, well, it doesn't want to support our current business. I saw one case a few years back when I started looking into caregiving. There was this absolutely amazing pitch from a company here in Berlin, and there was really this panel sitting there, and they were like, yeah, but we do not see how you would fit into our company. And I wanted to jump on the opportunity, like, well, let's talk. But they were very clear they want to be part of the company as well. And instead, it took, in my opinion, second class idea. It was in the diabetes market. They were very clear we want to grow our share of the diabetes, which I think is currently owned by Roche and other same players. So they wanted to attack them with that. And I was like, yes, it's a funny idea what they do, but what this small company does, but it's not going to push it into the big leap with that. But they paid an absolute premium money. Price. And last time I checked, they must have closed it down because this product was no longer visible on their website. And I think that's it, which is something that is standing, but still, we would sometimes wish for more vision. Yes, it's a company VC, that's the right word.
Yeah, that's very clear. And we discussed it. The thing is that really venture capital, it is in Germany in existence, but I don't know the numbers, but I think the corporate VC part is much bigger than the corporate VC part. And German VCs do completely different things than when they go to the United States or to the UK, where they're much more like, not like stupid to try things, but like, hey, come on, let's try. We don't know if it works or not. While if you find a VC in Germany like that,
cautious.
Yes, that's right. Yes.
The whole culture is different in the US. I think it's failure. It's like, okay, nothing special. It was just this, but here in Europe in general, I think it's not really
special. Yeah, that's what I want to do. Actually, in some countries, for example, originally being Portuguese, I left many years ago, but I remember if you fell in Portugal with a startup, the government actually punishes you as a director. So you have to pay all the money you lost, and you're not allowed to start a company for the next 5 years or so.
Okay.
So people are really afraid.
Is it crazy enough to
start
a company?
Wow. Yes. I think now it's better, but this is going back 20 years.
Okay.
And I think, yes, Europe has that approach. If you fail, that's it. You know, you're not. You shouldn't be running any more businesses, which is not the right thing to do.
You know, kind of dwarf, obviously,
yes.
You read the Rashomon story. The family who built Olympia Dwarf and then built kind of dwarf and failed on it for various reasons, which were very unfortunate. The one thing I remember is that the day the Olympia Dwarf filed for bankruptcy, the day after, George Soros called us there at home and said, let's start a fund for real estate. Soros had no idea about real estate. And when he was asked later, Mr. Akin declined. But when he was asked later about that call, he said, well, this guy had some knowledge. In most sense, he knew how to build a huge company. He knew what might go on. This is knowledge that you shouldn't produce. So this thinking is wonderful. It's the same here in Germany. I've grown to the point where I'm like, okay, I don't want to build businesses for anyone else, I do for myself. If I fail with something, I had a failure in my meetup with that, it's something I learned. I paid the price for it, and the important thing is what is the overall value that you have, what have you learned overall, and for sure that way more successes, or not by numbers again, but by volume, that where I was successful than the failures. And that's important for me.
Going back to the US, actually, if you don't have any failures, then take it seriously.
Yeah, because there was this one case where a judge was really so pissing me off. And at one time I said, listen, do you even have a PhD? Do you even fail with a PhD? He said, I did not write that, I did not even try a PhD. He said, that's the worst failure. I mean, failing on your PhD is forgivable because you're going to have the wrong presumption and you cannot prove it. That can help, but not even try it, that's the worst thing.
Yes. Yeah. I read the quote the other day, sorry, about that is someone said that they used to run a marathon. And he always come last, and you know, he celebrated like he won.
Yeah.
And I said, why are you celebrating? You're the last one.
Yeah.
Well, I'm so I came to the marathon, I ran 45 miles.
Yeah.
Maybe you know, 90% of the population did not even try to run the marathon.
Yeah.
And so I'm very happy. I said, okay, well done.
Yeah, exactly right.
To your question about Germany versus Netherlands, something you mentioned PhD, I didn't hear this. So in the Netherlands, when I put my title, usually I put it without doctor because you know it can mean plus or minus. rights for some people.
Okay.
But in Germany, I think this is something that is really valid, so it's different.
But I know, I know that 30 years ago it was really something. You could get jobs just because you're a doctor. You could get a banking job when you had a doctor in theology. So it was quite a popular science. But it is now. Personally, I found it very interesting to go into university. You learn things that has been pre-thought. You basically give it back, and suddenly go into this room nobody had touched before, or maybe it's very science, and you write something, you have to scan it, you have to defend it. So it's a very interesting process. So I really liked it and appreciated it. Even the time, it's a lot of time, and the outcome is biased. You could be working 3 years much more in the same time. So,
I think it's something to be very proud of, you know, something that, and if you say it's 90% of determination and 10% of
work.
And now that we're talking about qualification, there are a lot of entrepreneurs as well with MBAs, and they think that having an MBA that qualifies them to be successful in business, is that something that you see a lot, or it's just a general perception?
I think with entrepreneurship, it's mostly it's about the personality. I think that that's what it is. So you really need to have that that spirit, that personality. You need to be determined. You need to have the vision. An MBA or a PhD, that's the knowledge part. Nice to have, yes, perfect. But I think it's more about the other part. And you really need to enjoy that. As you said, now you see yourself in a, when you were building the company, you are happy with that, but not the next phase is coming. So you need a person with a personality that matches exactly with that role.
Yeah, I know one or two investors, they never went to school, they left school at 16, and they, you know, they are one of the biggest successful people in the country. But they always ask them, what is your number one regret in life? And they always say education.
Yeah.
Yes, I wish I would. But as an entrepreneur, they are the best. They know how to, well, not how to do anything, but you know, kind of get around things to make them succeed.
Well, I think you cannot have it all. So you just sort of one direction. I have chosen technology, and sometimes I'm saying there are many more interesting topics actually. But.
I mean, the very interesting role models that we have, the Bill Gates is among Zuckerbergs of the world and Broadcom, because they acted on a very good business model. I met that Bill Gates profile on LinkedIn, would be interesting. If it says Harvard Dropout, or if it says CEO of Microsoft, I don't know. And then you who famously said that he founded the company, he had already discovered it, and he was 54 or something like that. Okay, so it can be anything. I know that I'm 53, but the internet came around when I was already in my 30s. I would not have known what to do with it. Much younger. It wasn't that simple. It wasn't good. But I was in classes, and my computer was my best friend for years. But the opportunities you would not have seen it. And if you know a little bit more, I have also 5-6 different businesses. And then you get an idea of the opportunity really about how can you apply that. But the big step, I think, is to step back and say, all that we learned in school or whatever aside, we have a new technology, a new item here. Let's rethink what we're doing. Does it still make sense? Can we do it better? Then how can we act on that?
universities, the big companies, the tech entrepreneurs, you know, they go to college, grow up from Stanford or whatever. But, you know, they already have technical knowledge, so maybe you are still doing something. So they're not ignorant, if you like, in terms of technology. But at the same time, there is all this support system from the government, from the university, from everyone, which helped them, you know, scale up quite easily. And, you know, the incentives for that, which perhaps we don't see here in Europe, where it's more, well, let's see what you can do on your own, let's see how far they can go. And then if it fits us, then we'll try and help, if it, you know, later, you know, a few years later. Whereas in, from what I've seen in California, they help you from day one. So they say, oh, you know, I remember there was the app Monday, and it's very founders, and they, you know, it's like a spreadsheet with a lot of things that, you know, makes your scheduling very easy to do. But all the big companies, you know, they say, oh, who are you? We've never heard of you. What do you do? Let's see what you do. I say, okay, we'll give an enterprise license for, you know, $50,000 per user in our company, and we'll try it for a year. And immediately, I think they started with 1 or 2 million straight away. And you don't see that anywhere else, which is like the ecosystem helping each other from, you know, right from the start. And then they kind of propel that into very large companies.
I think it definitely mirrors the whole infrastructure that people find there. So, what is more for the fact that the mentor of Steve Jobs was actually a pair, the real pair, who lived a few blocks down in the BH Cotton Bay, asking for help, and when he was very young. I think that's an unforgivable mistake in our school system that there isn't a lot of punch on teachers, and basically the level of education of the teacher determines how much is allowed for the pupils to know in an area where a teacher should just accept, okay, while I've been educating pupils, technology went over my head, so we should find other ways. And I think that is much better solved in parts of finance as particularly in this simple. Also, because I think they have an incentive to do it, when the Stanford knows, okay, push out 1,000, which is also like we have to see that, they push out thousands of students, there are 2 or 3 super entrepreneurs, but the kickbacks from the super entrepreneurs are so large, they go for that. That is not something you see because that would be actually very weird if someone came and said, I give my alma mater a few million euros, they would be like, what do you want? You know, that's a different approach here in Europe, or at least in Germany.
Because there is no tradition of actually giving money back to universities, yes. It's all state. Mm-hmm. So the state actually has a big, I wouldn't say control, but big importance. How the entrepreneurial ecosystem works. Mm-hmm. So, whereas in the US is more private led. So, like you said, Stanford would say, we'll support you. But they know that in 3-4 years they're going to start giving back to them as well. So, that happens almost every day. They have so many students.
And, yeah, I mean, the difference is, as far as I'm aware, the United States is, as well as the incentive. But here's where it's the tax money, there's not a lot you can do, tiny amount you can do it, but it's really tiny. The government says, well, we are better distributed. And the question is, yes, it's more egalitarian, it's more widely distributed, but it fizzles out. Because it's like having one bucket of water from the country that raises humidity a little bit, but not really, versus pushing it somewhere and then having this point, which might sound to us Europeans unfair, and say, well, we get into Stanford, we get all this support, why don't we give it to everyone? But it does work on that. So, unfortunately.
which is like that, you know, it's shared community, which is a good, you know, it's a different approach. And, you know, that's happening now with technology markets where they're starting to clamp down Bitcoin and things like that,
yeah.
Regulations, and they want to share the wealth as much. But there is that merit, if you like, where Stanford, if they produce fantastic entrepreneurs, they should be rewarded for that. And maybe a university inside in the West, in the US, which only has one or two entrepreneurs, will get billions if that was the case.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Nothing.
Yeah,
you know, so it's kind of.
We have a participant tonight, who is a structure CEO of IT infrastructure development. Okay, it's no more the black and white screen. It's not really a new step of the game here, yeah. Which is sad. When you think you have like this typical tech risk in the old to do this back then, you have that. Well, the best thing for him or her would be to go overseas and go where they really, where they don't run into problems, but where they are a seller, where they can sit in a supercar and say, wait, stop, go with that, which is sad, but it's time for me. We still have amazing engineers in Germany. I'm sure about that. The thing with engineering is, once your third bridge crashes down, people start talking about you. So that's what you want to do. Not to have. But in terms of IT, it's still, I don't want to say being flustered, it's still a good entrepreneurs, but I'm just sure we can use it.
You look at classic examples, Tesla and Elon Musk. Now it's becoming a threat to Volkswagen, Mercedes.
Mm-hmm.
Only because, I mean, he already shared the technology with everyone, so everyone can use it. But it's only because he was first in the market and he had a vision. So if his engineering is not new, he just had that vision. Even it's the same with the space rockets. He went to Russia to buy the rockets, and the Russians said, "Who are you? You never heard of
me." He's the one deal. But indeed, he went to USA just to build a company, because that was the right place to be in.
And that's the ecosystem support.
Yeah, you have the ecosystem, you have your friends are also having your own companies, everybody is trying and failing. You know, you have also that social pressure to succeed. And, yeah, but still, if you think about Amsterdam and how much you are supported as an entrepreneur in the United States, I think it's still pretty okay. So, yeah, you know, depending on what you compare it with. So, you mentioned about the Portuguese rules, I'm thinking about North Macedonia, for example. So, still, this is, I think it's quite you have quite an okay support system also.
It's not very mature markets, especially in the investment.
It's more conservative, it's more cautious, as you said. So Elon Musk, he would be the first to do it, and now we can say yes, that works. So now let's build the same thing. So
which is a valuable business possibility.
Yeah.
You don't have to be the first.
No.
But good common carry. That's what made for Japan big. The first thing it's kind of similar. See what somebody else does, we copy plus.
Yeah,
that's a good focus as well. And that's what China did with 5G, the first with 5G, and now with the space as well. And they built their own international space station.
There's nothing wrong with copying.
No, I mean, it's just here, but then you have to be aware where are you in your position. And you must find out China doesn't have this abundance of cheap labor to the same. But they're like, okay,
Italy, which sounds a lot, but it's not a huge difference, given that it's one language, to say, well, we copy American products in Germany, that would be the wrong approach, because there is no particular business adaptation. The only thing where it works very well is car manufacturing, where the world is. It's still four wheels and an engine, it's still a gear, but they have this, this part is super reliable in contrast to General Motors cars. So you run that car, perhaps you can run it for 10 years, you don't run it, you can run it for 10 years, while General Motors cars probably have 3, 4, 5 years, you should drive out for the loop. And you can do it like that, but then you must be very conscious to protect this advantage that you have.
You copied the idea, which is 5% only, and the rest is execution. So
yeah, right.
You need to do it right, and you need to adapt it based on which location do you operate in, based on the market. And I think in countries that are less developed, there is a lot of opportunity to bring a lot of value to the society by copying what we have seen already from the European countries, let's say.
But how would that, I know for example some markets, like in France, you know, the labor market is very strict, you know, you cannot fire, you cannot to hire also, and they, you know, they are only allowed to work for 6 hours a week, and all these regulations, which is okay for them, but when you compare with other markets, China, someone working 50 hours a week, you know, doing the same work, you know, some, you know, productivity. It may not be the same productivity, but you know, the competition, the global competition. How could, for example, France do things quicker than China? If China is working double the time to do the same thing, you know, I don't know. Is it the pool of talent, or is it, you know, is there a secret to work less and do more? Can be kind of an enigma.
It's really 36 hours maximum as a rule in France.
Yeah,
okay,
it's
so
true.
But they still invent, they still have startups, they still do all this.
So if you have a startup, you cannot work 60 hours, let's say.
Officially.
Yeah, right. I think they don't send somebody and say, stop now.
No, I recently went to I read a book there in 3 weeks time again. I saw that first our ecosystem built a really difficult situations. And one of the things that I like that they use is they generally have a lot of foreign workers, a lot of people from former Yugoslavia. Now, Serbia is not part of the European Union. So they are, I wouldn't say stuck, but it's difficult